Today, I'm going to talk about a second order dampening system. And the dampening system is depicted over here. We have a mass, we have gravity acting downwards, and we have a spring, and we have a damper with constant C, and the spring has a constant K. There are four fixed rods here, sturdy rods, that pivot around these points over here. So if you move the mass up and down, these two points will move in and out. Okay, so if you move there up and down, this will move in the horizontal direction. And therefore the spring will and the damper will be loaded and unloaded accordingly if the mass goes up and down. Okay, so I'm going to solve this system using Lagrangians, as what we did before in one of my other videos. And in order to do that, we need to look at what the generalized coordinates are. And when you look at the picture, there's only, as I explained before already, there's only one movement. X goes up and down, and as a consequence, in the y direction, you get contraction or expansion. So there's only one coordinate here, there are not two. Because this y coordinate is, through geometry, is fully dependent on the x coordinate. Because these are sturdy rods. They don't flex, they don't bend. So if you move here, there is a direct connection between that movement and the horizontal movement in the y direction. And we will calculate that. Okay, so there's essentially only one coordinate, which is x. And that's it, right? So for the generalized coordinates, we have x, and the infinitesimal movement is delta x. There's one generalized force, and that's because there is a damper here. It's a non-conservative force, and there's a damper with constant C that will make sure that there's one generalized force in the system. And this generalized force you can calculate through the work formula F times delta R. And delta R is in this case delta X, and F is the force associated with the damper here. Now the first thing we need to do is we need to find a relation between movement in the x direction here and movement in the y direction. And for that we look at the equilibrium here. So this is the system in equilibrium. The four rods here have length L, 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 L and L, and the distance between these two points here is also L. And since it's a symmetric system, the rods here are the same length, this will be L over 2, and that will be L over 2. And then using the Pythagorean theorem, you can essentially calculate what this height is, and that's L over 2 square root of 3. Yeah? That's very simple and straightforward. Now you're going to move this point upwards. So you're going to move in a positive x direction. If you do that, you get this picture. You move x up. That means that these pieces will be a little bit longer. They will be L over 2 square root of 3, what this piece is, plus x over 2. Because this piece will move x over 2 and this piece will move x over 2. And these two pieces will be a little bit shorter as a consequence from moving this thing up. Okay? So how much shorter is that? Well, it's essentially L squared, what you see over here, minus the length of this squared, square root of that, and you have this piece here. Now, because it is a symmetric system, you have the same movement here also. So there's a 2 here. So now the length of this piece is essentially this piece over here. Okay? And then yx, of course, how much it actually moved. So if you move x a certain amount, how much does the horizontal movement incur? And that's L minus that piece, of course, because the original equilibrium position was L. You move x up, this becomes a little bit longer, this becomes a little bit shorter, so you have to subtract a value from it. So it's L minus that piece that we calculated. You can simplify that and you will get this. Okay, so now we have an expression for yx. So now we are in a position to actually calculate a generalized force, F1, which is on a dampener, by definition, minus C times y dot. Y dot is dy dx, dy dt, sorry. Y dot is dy dt. So if you want to calculate dy dt, you have to take yx, you do first do a dy dx, and then you do a dx dt. The dx dt is stated here, x dot, and the dy dx is the differentiation of this function here. And that's what happened here. So if you differentiate dy to x, you will get this value here. And obviously you copy minus c. Okay? Now for the infinitesimal displacement, dr1, which is dy in the y direction. Y is in that direction, x is going up in the positive direction. Again, you have to differentiate y. So you get a similar type of expression as this, what you see here. But now you have to multiply it by dx, of course. And now we can combine these two. And we get this work, this infinitesimal work, by multiplying these two factors, this one and this one, multiply it out, and you get your generalized force. You can read off your generalized force, and that's depicted over here. And that's the generalized force we later need when we want to calculate the equations of motion. So now let's first do the Lagrangian. Let's calculate our Lagrangian. Lagrangian is T minus V, kinetic energy minus potential energy. And for clarity, I copied yx because we need that. Let's start with the kinetic term. If you look at this system, there's only one kinetic term in this system. And that's because there's only one mass here. There's a mass here, so this one has a kinetic term. These rods here are massless in our model, so there will not be any kinetic terms there. If they would have had mass, we would have had to include them. But there is none. So there's only one kinetic term. So that's a half mv squared. And v is obviously the speed of this mass going up and down. And that's x dot, dx dt. So the kinetic energy is only a half m x dot squared. And that's it. If we go to the potential energy terms, there are essentially two terms. The spring has potential energy. If you press it, it gets potential energy. If you release it, it will be released. So there's potential energy there. And there's potential energy because there's gravity, so there's potential energy in the mass here. Now to start with this one, the potential energy is quite simple. That's just m times g times x, okay? Where x is the height of the mass, and if it goes up, the potential energy goes up. If it goes down, the potential energy goes down. And the potential energy of the spring, according to Hooke's law, is just a half k y squared x. So that's a half k times that y that we calculated in our previous slides. Yeah, so you quadratize it and you get your potential energy of the spring. Now we are in a position to add those up, and we come to a Lagrangian here, which is a half mx dot squared minus a half k times yx squared minus mgx. Yeah, you do t minus v, and therefore you get the minus signs here. Minus here, minus there, even though those are plus. Okay? So now we are going to solve this Lagrange equation and make an equation of motion out of it. And we do that by the standard way. The Lagrange equation is this. Generalized forces on the right. The Lagrangians are on the left. You have to differentiate against x dot and then to ddt. And you have to differentiate against x in this case. When you do that based on this Lagrangian, we get the following. And for clarity, I also inserted the generalized force. And I made a simplification defining alpha x, which is this piece here. Otherwise, it becomes so verbose and cumbersome. in the expressions. So we're going to work out the Lagrangian, and what we will see is the first thing we have to do is differentiate towards x dot. Now x dot, there's only one x dot in this Lagrangian equation, so that's very easy. So it's m times x dot, and that needs to be differentiated towards t, so you get an mx double dot over here. Now you have to minus the Lagrangian towards x. Let's start with a simple term here. So it's minus minus, that becomes a plus, so you get mg here if you differentiate that towards x. And if you differentiate this toward x, you get this piece. Yeah, you can easily verify that. It's just an exercise in calculus, which I did not do here, but it's definitely correct, the results that I provided to you. So minus kappa, okay, times alpha x minus l times square root of 3l plus x over alpha x. And that equals the generalized force. And that's the generalized force we calculated before of the dampener over here. Okay, so now we can rewrite that a little bit to make an equation that equals zero. So we just take c to the other side and we have the equation of motion here. Now the equation of motion here is non-linear. It's a second order differential equation because you have differentiation towards the time two times here. So it's a second order differential equation, but it's not linear because there's this complex equation here that there's a dependency on x. So this is really hard to solve. Now in the next slide, I'm going to make some approximations to actually make it a little bit simpler so we can draw some conclusions from it. So again, we have the complex differential equation of second order. We have alpha x here for reference. That's filled in here, here, and here. And what we're going to do next is we're going to make a Taylor expansion around zero, assuming x is much smaller than l. And x is the movement vertically here, and l is the length of the bar here. So these bars. So it is assumed that the movement is very small compared to the length of the bars, which is very reasonable to do. And if you do that in a Taylor expansion, so you do a Taylor expansion of first order in x over L, you will get this equation here. And you can just type it into Mathematica or you do it by hand. It's tedious, but it's not hard to do. And you get this equation. Yeah, so you get mx double dot plus c times 3 plus 8 times square root of 3x over L times x dot plus mg minus 3k times x equals 0. And you can still see that there is an issue here with the x over L here. So as a second approximation, I'm going to assume that this is small compared to 3, which is very reasonable. And in most systems, practical systems, that will be the case. Yeah, and I do this because we can see some interesting physics coming out of it, and we can compare it with a slightly different system that has a similar function. Okay, so once we do that, so we take this out, we get a linear differential equation of second order, and we can actually solve this one. Yeah, so that's pretty cool. So now you can go back to one of my other videos and see, oh, this is how you solve it, because I do this in one of my other videos. I will place a link in the description to point you towards it. So now let's take a look at another slightly different dampening system, here depicted on the right. And this dampening system is essentially performs a similar function as the dampening system on top here, but there is no geometrical structure here. But if you would calculate the equation of motion of this dampening system, you will see that it will result in a system like this. And if you look carefully, that is exactly the same as here, except for the fact that c here is 3c there and k here is 3k there. So simply by using geometry, we have an ability to change the k of the spring and the c of the dampener by simple geometry. And that happens a lot in practice. In practical systems, you can do this, for instance, to save cost. if it is very expensive, for instance, to buy a certain dampener with a certain C value or a spring with a certain K value, and you need quite a high value, you can say, okay, I'm going to make a construction like this, because here the C's and the K's essentially are three times as big as here. Yeah, that could be beneficial in certain cases. So I think this is a really cute way of doing, using geometry to change the constants in the system of this second order differential system. Okay, I think this is a great place to stop. If you like this video, please subscribe and please like, and I'll see you in the next.